Now, would like to open the floor for questions or comments. I would like you to introduce yourself and address the question to our speakers. Everybody has a mic in front of him, so
yes, please. Yes. Okay.
Thank you for the two speakers. Professor, we have a lot of questions, but one of our really clinical confusion. How common to have a neonate discharge from the normal nursery, went home, stay for 48 hours, come back again to the emergency with neonatal jaundice? Shall we admit him to an ICU if he need, or we get scared from this community acquires infection and we don't want to him to get mixed with our premature baby? We get a debate, shall we go to PICU if he need exchange transfusion, or in ICU is the best place to readmit them back if they went from the normal nursery?
Okay. Good question. I would suggest that wherever you, it doesn't really matter to you if you put the baby in the NICU or PICU or whatever, but you have to decide beforehand on a systematic level where you're going to put such a baby. So if you're going to put the baby in the PICU because of infectious disease risk, then that NICU must have phototherapy units available. They should not have to run to a different floor or a different building, because that wastes time. So the place that you designate needs to be equipped to do what they need to do. That, I think that's the crucial point. It doesn't matter where it is. It helps, I think, if the staff who are going to do it are experienced. And that, in my country, speaks for the NICU, but not necessarily here. I wouldn't know.
Okay. Yes.
Thanks a lot, Prof. Hansen. I have a comment and a question. I think we're in Saudi Arabia. We're way from what you're doing in Norway with regard to the detection of cases of severe hyperbilirubinemia and prevention of care nectarous. Our nurseries in Saudi are covered by the most junior doctors. They're examined and they're discharged. Mothers are not counseled properly. They're discharged from the hospital by the most junior staff. They're admitted under our names, but we never see them. The other thing, once they go home, they're seen in the first visit in Saudi after 2 months of discharge with the first vaccination. We don't have a close follow-up for babies who are discharged. So we're really way behind what you're doing in Europe and North America. So our best approach for a fast catch in this is to try to detect the cases that are most likely to develop severe hyperbilirubinemia. So doing a transcutaneous bilirubin before discharge is very, very important. So what about doing other tests like N-tidal carbon monoxide detection, like what Dr. Bhutani has been doing? I noted that you haven't mentioned anything about that. Can we detect the most vulnerable cases in our country to focus on those till we fix the other systems that we have?
I think if you're going to use carbon monoxide, it needs to be part of an integrated formula. Carbon monoxide measurements are very interesting research tools, but they cannot be used alone. I think I understand the situation you are describing, and I'm calling upon you to use your ingenuity, which I'm sure there is lots of in Saudi Arabia also. And I think these new phone-based devices may be something that could help parents communicate to you. So that may be something. Now, I've been twice in Ethiopia recently, and they obviously are nowhere near the advanced level of development that you are. And I was planning a study involving some medical students, and one of the questions was, how in the world are we going to get follow-up of these babies? And they looked at me like the stupid guy I was, because everybody, although they couldn't read or write, had a cell phone. So there was no problem. So I think these new cell phone-based devices may be helpful, and I think education, I think, is a key step. Training your junior staff. If they are not told that this is potentially serious, then they're not going to take it seriously. I don't know about this country, but in Norway now, we have a small but very vocal group of people who tell us that immunization is bad, and it's better to get the disease and develop immunity from it. And I tell them, you know what, I worked in Africa for 2.5 years. I've seen babies die from measles. I've seen babies or children paralyzed from polios. Don't tell me about it being better. But these things are so rare that we need to educate ourselves. We need to educate our colleagues, our students, our nurses, our nurse practitioners. We need to educate each other, because a rare event, just by the nature of its being rare, is something that we need to be reminded of all the time. Now, I happen to have bilirubin not exactly on the brain, but quite present in my mind, so I think about it all the time. And when I look at the efforts that I have in our NICU to keep retraining our staff again and again and again and again, and in all lack of humility, I'm the Norwegian champion of neonatal jaundice. And even in my NICU, I have to keep pestering people about it. So it's attention, 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 and then use your ingenuity and look at what are your social factors, what are your health service factors, and how can you tailor or tweak those to reduce the lag time, to make access easier. So yeah, I think it's possible.
Yes. Yes, sir. Press the button, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Prof, for the nice presentations, and I must congratulate you for running this very comprehensive program for prevention of the connectors. I think we are in our country, we are still having a problem. We have done 2 exchanges in my unit last year. It's a small unit where we have only 1,200 deliveries per year. But the practice is different from place to another. I am seeing the babies, all of them, and I'm screening them before discharge, and we are following them closely. But still, I think education is very important. Education to both parents and the medical staff. Because even if you give them appointments many times, they will slip out, they will not come. Or sometimes they get wrong advice, like you mentioned, expose babies to natural or even artificial light for treatment. But I think we still need to have a comprehensive program for these babies, especially in areas where we have a lot of G6PD deficiency, like in the eastern part where I live. We have like 30% of our babies are G6PD deficient. Luckily, we are screening them, but I know in many hospitals they do not screen the babies at birth. And we still have a lot of problems in like identifying or even making a diagnosis of the G6PD deficiency. What level is really G6PD deficient in a cord blood sample? And how can we get it in time before we discharge the babies? So many questions we have to discuss, I think, between us as neonatologists in my country.
Thank you for that comment. I would think now our guidelines in Norway are national, and they were created by the Norwegian Pediatric Association more than 10 years ago, and just last year we revised them based on experiences, and in fact our Danish colleagues have more or less adopted our guidelines. I would suggest that perhaps your neonatal society could take a leading role in working out national guidelines. In Norway, our guidelines are present and available online. They are used in every NICU in the country and every maternity in the country. So every baby all over Norway is treated according to the same guidelines. And once again, I don't for a second believe that our success, if you would call it that, is due to where we drew the lines on the chart. We have no more science behind this than does the American Academy of Pediatrics or anybody else. I think our success is in the total package.
Dr. Hibley?
I have a question for Dr. Sahafi. Briefly mentioned the management, and you said we know better as neonatologists. Unfortunately, we have a continuing dilemma in the management of TBA and cholestasis. From your opinion, what we usually argue about is stop or reduce amino acid, stop or reduce the intralipid. What is the current recommendations in this field in severe TBA and cholestasis?
So for the amino acid, the only thing that we have to, there's some data that mentioned that it's controversial that more load of amino acid cause more damage to the liver. And also, not only the dose, the duration that the baby on the amino acid. So adjusting that, one of the options that once we have the process, in addition to that, we have to check for the certain amino acid level, because as I mentioned, that taurine and carnitine and other that we need it for conjugation and excretion and mitochondrial function. And if there is deficiency in that aspect, we have to correct it as soon as possible. And there is some animal study that, and some one or two clinical study that they have some success in correcting the or improving the jaundice or facilitating the recovery. For the lipid now, the people are going now with the balance, because the soy base, they're causing problem with the omega-6 as inflammation-induced or pro-inflammatory agent, and now the omega-3 fish, and then the third generation of the lipid coming to the market. I think in our hospital introduced just, I think, 3 months ago that we are using that. And omega vim before that has been used and show some result. But the problem we found that when we worked in the transplant center that even the patient, if you start omega vim, some baby, the bilirubin will improve. But when you do the biopsy, there is some cirrhosis there. So, and they will develop portal hypertension, and then they will go for the transplant workup. So lipid, one of the things that we have to use the most appropriate things, I think now I do believe third generation is the one that we have to use. Second, that you think about the carbohydrate, how to optimize that with the appropriate calorie just to maintain the growth. Third, that the amino acid, we can reduce the dose, and we can try also. And also that if there is any chance for enteral feed, that will help a lot. I think this is the ultimate goal, to keep the baby on full feed and stop the TBN and give time 3 months, 4 months for full recovery from the insult of the TBN. It is a difficult decision because the things that just last point, that is multifactorial, that yes, we think that TBN, but also there is other things that happen to the baby, like sepsis, like deficiency in some amino acid. And then fixing the TB or manipulating the TBN alone, that you are playing only with one factor that have sub factor under that, but also there is another factor we have to think about it. And sometimes it's difficult to fine tune things or fix things, but time will do the job if we stop the TBN.
Any question from the female side? Okay. Please go ahead.
I would like to ask a question of my colleague about the TPN. Do you think that many babies, at least in our minic, you get partial parenteral nutrition? Okay. Yeah. Does it matter? Does it help if at least they get some enteral nutrition, even if they get much by parenteral? Does that make a difference in the course?
Yeah, for sure. And there is some data mentioned that percentage of the TBN and the enteral feed, the more enteral feed, the more enhancement of enteral hepatic circulation. Our problem is that the stagnation of the toxic metabolite within the liver. So once we enhance the enteral hepatic circulation, even by minimum 25% of the calorie coming from the enteral feed, 75 from TBN, and then we can increment that. That will help a lot. If if the bowel integrity is okay and there's no resection and there's no stoma interfering with these things. Our problem also with the ileal resection that interrupted the anterior hepatic circulation, but for sure that starting even partial enteral feed will help in minimizing the effect on the liver.
Okay. Dr. Hussein?
I'd like to thank all speakers for nice coverage and excellent coverage. I have a comment and one question. When we come across immunoglobulin in the literature, we're always saying that specificity and equality is a problem. I think it's in the last 2 decades, no study has shown any significant result other than RH and ABM compatibility of little wire jet one. So we have to omit this as your comment. Second question, what range of irradiants you are using in your guidelines as a phototherapy?
Yeah, thank you very much. In the first guidelines, we said 20 microwatts per square centimeter per nanometer. In the revision from last year, we're recommending 30 microwatts per square centimeter per nanometer as intensive irradiance. We have just completed a one-year national prospective study of phototherapy, which also included site visits to all NICUs in Norway. And the one of the interesting observations, and we had nurses with little and more experience setting up devices, and then we went in and measured irradiance in the devices. And one of the interesting findings which we will take home and utilize is that although average irradiance was decent, the range or the spread of the irradiance from one nurse to the next was very significant, which is a quality control problem. Because if that nurse who sets up the device in such a way that the irradiance is only 15 rather than 30, and she happens to be on call when that baby who is pre-carnicteric comes in and needs intensive phototherapy, that's a quality control problem that we are going to confront now in the light of those findings. So in other words, training, I think is the key to this.
Okay. Dr. Jubar.
Thank you very much. My question for Dr. Hansen. Maybe we had a different experience in National Guard. We were able for the last 5 years to create a jaundice clinic running 6 days. The baby after discharge, they come to that clinic, we check their serum bilirubin, and we were able to reduce the need of exchange transfusion and the admission for severe hyperbilirubinemia. My question, now we are seeing a baby with no risk, and they have severe hyperbilirubinemia. Do you have the same? And if yes, what is the explanation? No risk factor, but they presented with severe hyperbilirubinemia.
I'm not so sure that I have the best possible answer to that excellent question. What I do suspect is in light of the last 10, 15 years of discovery of genetic variants in bilirubin metabolism is that there are still risk factors that we are not able to discover when we look at the baby. And I see in the future a potential genetic risk screening chip for neonatal jaundice, perhaps to be taken together with our metabolic disease screening, and hopefully something of a device that could detect, for instance, those who have Gilbert genetics. Babies who have Gilbert genetics, in my experience, even in Norway, most people who have Gilbert, adults who have Gilbert, are not aware of it. So over the years, my custom has been to, when I sit with parents, with babies, with prolonged or high levels of jaundice, I never ask them if they have Gilbert because they just shake their heads, but I ask them, do you, when you get ill or you fast or you get sick in some way, sometimes become yellow on the whites of your eyes? Because that, you know, happens with Gilbert patients. And a funny thing, some years ago, a father who had happened to spend several years in Italy, he looked at me and said, you know, I happen to know I have something called Gilbert syndrome. But he was the first one I've ever met who was aware, except for another patient that I met 30 years ago who was also aware that he had Gilbert. But most people in the population who have Gilbert are not aware. So I think there are other genetic risk factors that could contribute to babies with unexpectedly high levels of bilirubin. So those babies, I think you're having a clinic. It's a good thing. Our maternities in Norway have a breastfeeding clinic, which is open every day. And the moms come with their babies. And sometimes jaundice is picked up in those breastfeeding clinics.
Any more questions? Can we give the chance for the ladies? Then we'll get back to you. Please.
Thank you for all speakers. Again, for neonatal jaundice. My opinion that all babies here screened before discharge seen by a neonatologist or at least working in the ICU field, he has experience to detect jaundice. For considering the risk factors if the baby is subjected to get a neonatal jaundice after, I think this is the big problem here in the society that mothers and grandmothers, they are considering neonatal jaundice is a mild or benign thing. They are going outside. We are trying to educate the mother. If there is risk factors, we are educating the mother to come back within 1 or 2 days again. If the baby has no jaundice, for babies with Rh negative mother, there is special protocols in our hospitals to guard against to get high bilirubin. But if the mother is going out, they are considered that this jaundice is normal for babies. We are treating, mothers are continuing to treat outside, maybe coming late in our clinic again with high, if the mother is seeing the baby is become lethargic, no feeding, so she's coming with high bilirubin level, and this is the time that is baby in need for us. We see so many babies coming with level with an exchange transfusion level and managed in, but with sickly. I think the problem for education.
Can you say your question, please?
Yes. This is just to comment this, we need for national program for education of the mother to get, if the baby has jaundice, to come to the hospital. Because mostly, even if the doctor is educating the mother, also this is not enough. I think it's need a big program for education. But just I want to ask for that. Thank you.
Do you often see connectors in your babies? Do you see connectors in your babies?
How we see?
Not connectors.
Well, I think you have a very good point about education. And unfortunately, because connectors is, at least in my country, such an exceptionally rare phenomenon, it's not just the moms that we have to educate. It's the staff. We have to educate the staff all the time because the staff also says, well, jaundice is a benign. I can't tell you the number of times that I have been told, you know, I called your maternity about jaundice and they said, that's a normal phenomenon. You know, just relax, feed the baby more. And every time I run down to the chief nurse in the maternity ward and said, I'm going to kill you.
Last question from Dr. Abbas Lamra.
Thank you very much. We were planning to do a study on testing the theory that those who have G6PD deficiency, the less the G6PD level, the more jaundice and the longer duration of phototherapy they need. But then we had the question, is what criteria we shall use to decide on discontinuing phototherapy. We didn't find in the literature that what CAT level or what criteria you use to do phototherapy. And then the other question is, do you need to do more bilirubin levels to decide if the bilirubin just drop below the level, then you discontinue, or what should we do?
The first question is that there is, unfortunately, no scientific answer to it. In our guidelines, we were just pragmatic. We picked a number, and we said, if the total serum bilirubin at any point in time during phototherapy drops to more than 20 micromoles per liter below the limits, you can stop. If you are on the part of the curve that is still rising, if you are 50 micromoles below, you can stop. And but these are just pick and number things, because there is, to the best of my knowledge, no solid science behind it. And your second question,
The other question is, if you want to decide on the duration, how would you follow the serum bilirubin level? I mean, okay. You need to decide exactly what time is needed for discontinuation of phototherapy.
Okay, our guidelines aim to keep the duration as brief as possible, because if there is any evidence at all about toxicity of bilirubin, and there is, or toxicity of phototherapy, and there is, but that's too long a story to go into now, it certainly behooves us to keep duration as short as possible. In our revised guidelines, we say no less frequent than twice a day, Q12 hours. And of course, if you have a baby in the NICU, you may get a blood gas Q6 hours, and our blood gas machines have bilirubin biocoximetry integrated, so we get them there four times a day. And then if you're below the guidelines, our nurses are given the responsibility of acting on those bilirubin values. So if it's 20 micromoles or more below, they will turn the lights off.
Okay, thank you very much. By this, we come to the end of the first session. Thank you to our excellent speakers. Thank you for your audience, for your interactions. It's time for the coffee break.